Lunch. 400 bag lunches will be on sale in the lobby at $5 a piece. A little steep as far as I can see. The closing session will be in Hall B. All of us here at the table have been asked at one time or another, are you now, have you ever been related to that other Cockburn? And all of us, being principled and forthright, have at one time or another said, never heard of him before in my life. So you can take this as a kind of brief, at least geographical, testimonial to family unity before we go back to the old denials and evasions that have served us so well in the past. We're here to talk about the press, the military, and the Soviet Union within the framework of anti-communism. And so just so you don't think this is purely a family reunion, let me note by way of introduction my brother's credentials. Andrew has studied both the US military and the Soviet military and their respective military industrial apparatuses for the past decade, and has done TV, films, and a book, which I hope all of you have read or will rush out and purchase, The Threat, about the Soviet Union and its armed forces. Patrick has served as the London Financial Times Soviet correspondent in Moscow between 1986 and 1988 and is now a senior pundit and thinker at the Carnegie Endowment, which at the moment is full of very, very disappointed people who thought they were going to be advising President Dukakis about Soviet affairs. I'm a kind of lower grade hack, which means that I get to make some preliminary observations about the press and anti-communism in general. Andrew will then talk about anti-communism as the essential motor powering the military-industrial complex that keeps US capitalism afloat. And then Patrick will talk about how the Soviet Union is perceived by the US reporters who supply most Americans with what little they're allowed to know about the Soviet Union. And I think we'll talk probably for around an hour, and then there'll be an hour for people to make, hopefully, brief statements of philosophical opinion, cross-examine us, and do all the other things that audiences should do. I'd like to say something initially. I think anti-communism's taken a terrible pasting at this conference. And I'd like to say a couple of its achievements, because they've been a bit not mentioned, really. If you translate anti-communism as competition with the Soviet Union. Now, the most significant, probably, was the desegregation of the armed forces of the United States in 1948, which is, of course, a vital step in the path to the civil rights movement, which flowered in the 60s, which in turn was a vital step in, I think, the organization of the women's movement, which flowered in the 70s. And as you know, the desegregation was ordered by Truman following a number of things. The threat to the Democratic Party by Henry Wallace, threat from the left, and the emerging struggle with the Soviet Union, particularly for support and the opinion of the Third World, in which struggle it was quite clearly a disadvantage to have segregation and segregated armed forces. So that's one major achievement of anti-communism right there. And another one, of course, is in the field of higher education. And I might point out in this connection Sputnik, which led to a great leap forward in funding for higher education, and more recently Star Wars, where, you know, if you really want to study almost anything like the flight of the honeybee, as long as you say it's in connection with the Star Wars program, you'll get a wad of money from the Pentagon. Now, a few words about the press and its role in engineering consent, as the famous phrase of Bernays went. That is, engineering the consent of the governed to existing social and economic relations and arrangements under capitalism. Now, there are a number of theories about how the press arrives at its state, and you heard some of them the other night, those of you who attended the initial panel, and you have what we might call the creationist view, which is that suddenly, somehow, for no explicable reason, journalists all seem to support capitalism support basically the level of defense spending and other things, by with no sort of intervention by things like bosses or outside forces of any sort. This is a view often held by journalists, oddly enough. Or you can have another theory, which is sort of evolutionary social Darwinism, that the higher you get on the journalistic tree, you get an increasingly ruthless selection of sort of brutal, brutish, ignorant defenders of the capitalist order. I think there are a number of important premises, which oddly enough were raised rather negatively, I thought, by Mr. Corsini in the first session, who I thought said he was from the Italian Communist Party, which slightly told one a lot about the Italian Communist Party, but but he did say a rather interesting thing. I mean, he inadvertently, really, that in that newspapers in Italy tended to be tied to political parties, whereas here he said there wasn't this what he seemed to think was an unfortunate state of affairs, and therefore, in his view, there was an absolute torrential wave of information on all important matters to be found in the U.S. press. Well, of course. There's one party here, which is the party of business, essentially. And this is very important. There is no, and I think I tried briefly to say this, and it's very important about the structure of the press here, there is no major social democratic party in this country, which means that you don't even have that countervailing balance. In Britain, you have, for better or for worse, the Labour Party. For worse, I mean, almost always. But the fact of the matter is that the poor old nag is still, at least nominally, attached to certain principles, like the common ownership of the means of production, distribution, and exchange. Unless they... Have they banned that one yet? Which means that it is possible for journalists to, if you've got that weight of at least theological opinion in the society, it can be reflected at some level in the major media, which is fairly important. And that's not true here. Now, how here does opinion get legitimized? I think it's a very important issue in the general assumptions which are expressed in the major media, the basic assumptions of the society. This matter of legitimation is obviously A, by the one-party system, the business party system, and B, I think increasingly by institutions, a series of institutions usually organized by business and by conservative millionaires. I could name, for example, the American Enterprise Institute, the Heritage Foundation, the Georgetown Center for Strategic and International Studies, and slightly less so these days, Brookings, Carnegie, at the what nominally at least the more liberal end of the spectrum. And if you start just taking a note, if you start writing down the affiliations of licensed experts who appear, let's say, on McNeil Lehrer or on the Koppel Show, you'll find that, let's say, Georgetown arises with truly amazing frequency. I mean, there must be a sort of holding room there. Now, within the papers themselves, you have a sort of pecking order as you go up of the social Darwinist process. So at the top usually emerge, for example, white men. Media industry in this country is run by white males. Fairly important, actually. And also white men who are anti-communist, it has to be said, as a general rule. Although you have to be a little careful about this, and this raises something interesting, that people defending the idea of anti-communism could say that at various times, you know, there's a lot to be anti-communist about. Authoritarian rule, purges, gulags, and the like. And a press person might say, well, you're accusing the press of being anti-communist. I mean, it's got a lot to be anti-communist about. But I think if people are saying that, then you have to think of a really remarkable thing that happened in the era of Richard Nixon, which, of course, was the opening to China. Now, if you recall it, when Nixon and Kissinger went to China, it was rapidly followed by many journalists who suddenly discovered the infinite beauties and wonders of the Chinese system. Now, as far as I know at that time, although as far as I can see, capitalism has now been entirely restored, There'd been no major change in China. It was an authoritarian country, had a very large number of political prisoners, had actually very considerable human rights abuses. And yet you had a situation in which A.M. Rosenthal, the former executive editor of the New York Times, and currently like an incredibly bad columnist, but important that he's bad. It reveals that a very, very right-wing stupid man ran the New York Times for a very long time, which is sort of interesting disclosure. But he went to China, and some of you may recall the article he wrote, which was Confessions of a New China Hand. And some of you may recall that about the time that A.M. Rosenthal was going around China, the Chinese had taken the habit of trundling condemned prisoners around in trucks for the edification of the people, and then taking them off and shooting them. Which state of affairs A.M. Rosenthal felt no particular urge to report or discuss. Though had the same thing happened in the Soviet Union, I think A.M. Rosenthal would have felt impelled to write several thousand words about it. So one has to be fairly careful at equating anti-communism and anti-Sovietism and saying you have to evaluate the reasons why these things occur. By the way, in case anyone thinks I'm being unfair to the New York Times, which I always try to be, I should just... and about A.M. Rosenthal, we should remember that his opposite number at the... when A.M. Rosenthal was developing into an extreme anti-communist out of his background in New York, his life at City College and so forth, you had over at the Washington Post Ben Bradley, who at an early stage of his career was working in the U.S. Embassy in Paris, and according to some documents, I think, recovered, one of his functions was to try and temper European opinion, which was rather opposed to the trial and execution of the Rosenbergs, doing a little water carrying for the CIA. And one of his colleagues in the U.S. Embassy was Arno de Borchgrave, currently running that very fine paper, The Washington Times. Now, when people talk about the press in the Soviet Union, they quite often say, well, this man at Izvestia, or this man running the information department, a chap at Pravda, had previously been in the KGB or previously been in some other department of US government, and this somehow indicates the rather monolithic nature of opinion and government formation in the Soviet Union. It's actually always quite interesting to apply these kind of analyses to the US press. For many long years, I was fond of pointing out, and still am fond of pointing out, for example, the origins of the successive national security correspondents of the New York Times. I mean, if you follow the career pattern of Leslie Gelb, for example, who at the moment is fairly high-ranking ideological commissar in the sense that he's the assistant opinion page editor. He began life in the Defense Department. Among other things, he supervised the preparation of the Pentagon Papers. He then went to the Brookings Institution, and from the Brookings Institution he went to the New York Times, where he became the national security correspondent. And from the New York Times he went to the Carter State Department, Bureau of Political Military Affairs, where after there, among which duties he had the work in cooperation with the CIA trying to inflect European opinion about the freeze. Then returned to the New York Times. Meanwhile, his successor at the New York Times is, of course, Richard Burt, who had begun life at Tufts, gone to the Institute for International Strategic Studies in London, then went to the New York Times, and then he went to, some of you may remember, the Bureau of Political Military Affairs, succeeding Leslie Gelb, but this time under Ronald Reagan, where he went to be the ambassador in West Germany, and I think is just at the moment being disappointed in his hopes of being a very high ranker in the Bush administration. Imagine what fun they would have if that pattern had been repeated in the Soviet Union. Now, I don't want to give you the idea that the press in all areas is entirely conservative. In a number of areas, the relationship of the press to expertise and institutional opinion works in different ways. For example, in areas such as the environment, the people, the press, tend to reach out, although decreasingly so, tend to still maintain the general view, which is not that of business, that toxics are bad for you and you can get poisoned by lethal chemicals, you know, whereas business takes a different view, that there's things called risk, and in a free market, if you die, that's bad luck, but not necessarily reflective of any bad behavior on the part of business. Context is very important. For example, the Los Angeles Times, which has a relatively liberal editorial policy on such matters as Central America, is a city in which there are a very large number of exiles from Salvador who are refugees from oppression by the military there. On the other hand, the Miami Herald, naturally set in Miami, is surrounded by the most vociferous and right-wing group of exiles in the country, and this has an effect. In some areas, such as Latin American studies, there is a wave band of respectable liberal opinion. It is still legitimate to hold the view that it's not necessary to solve the problems of Central America by immediate invasion, for example. There are areas where progressive opinion has more or less vanished from the press. For example, the economy, where Keynesians have become extinct, virtually, except for Len Silk on the New York Times, who still espouses more or less Keynesian positions. But in the recent election period, if you think about it, the leading obsession of the press is the deficit. It's the sole reason the New York Times endorsed Michael Dukakis, as a matter of fact, is his supposed vigor in, would have been his supposed vigor in diminishing the deficit. This is absolutely wholly writ in the press that the big problem of the US economy is the deficit. Whereas, in fact, a large stretch of Keynesian opinion says it's absolute nonsense. The deficit isn't that big a problem. But here you have an absolutely unanimous voice in the press, because the licensed expertise in the press from economists would tend to be from Friedmanites. And the Friedmanite vision of the world, of the relationship between the United States and the Third World, is almost exclusively these days Friedmanite, i.e. they talk about turning them towards market-oriented policies. If you, for example, study the journalism about Chile, you'll get a series of, in prominent papers, the most... You mean everything has been for waste? Do you want me to start again? This is outrageous. This is sabotage. Oh, hold on. Take another example, which Andrew will be talking about a bit, is the attitude to weapons. It so happens that expertise has that. God, you really do have to get your head down. The attitude to... Okay. How's that? In the area of weapons and the performance of weapons procurement in the Pentagon, there are a number of very well-informed people who are hostile and critical of many of the weapons and policies devised by the Pentagon. Those people known as the military reform lobby. Over the last 5 years, actually, journalism about weapons technology has been fairly good. So the relationship all the time between received expert opinion and the press is very important to study. Which brings us directly to the Soviet Union. For many years, knowledge about the Soviet Union was supplied almost always by exiles from the Soviet Union, who of course were ferociously hostile to the Soviet Union. There are some signs of change there. And at the moment, I think we're in a very interesting phase in the posture of the press towards the Soviet Union. On the one hand, you have the attitude to Gorbachev, in which the basic attitude of the press is that hopefully he'll restore capitalism. This is the basic way they see Gorbachev. And I know Patrick will want to talk more about that. But immediately certain problems arise which are or have been seen, are being seen by US elites. That if you say that Gorbachev is ascendant, if you say that he seems hopefully will restore capitalism and does seem to be accelerating detente, then how do you justify the $300 billion budget of the United States? I mean, you can't forever rely on the ACLU as the major threat. Now extant in society. So I think over the next period, you'll have a great deal of uncertainty about how to parse the threat, what kind of threat the Soviet Union actually poses. Also, you'll see, I think, a great deal of parsing about an absolute central axiomatic shibboleth in US journalism, which has been the sanctity of the Atlantic Alliance. When all else fails, you have the Atlantic Alliance. Everything has been basically seen in terms of Soviet policy. Will they split the Atlantic Alliance? Now, in 1992, you will have the final formal union of the common market, creation of the largest market in the world, and a very serious economic challenge to the United States, at which point I think the sanctity of the alliance will come under increasing question. So at the present time, we have a certain measure of flux in the way the press addresses itself to world problems that we haven't really seen, at least in this version, in the post-war period. Now, to analyze further this crisis of the threat, and hence this crisis of the threat to the leading, the economic motor of US society, I'll turn it over to Andrew.
I don't know how far down my throat I have to shove this thing, but can you hear me? Well, it is true, picking up on Alexander's saying, the sorry position or potentially sorry position of a threat these days. I've been struck, certainly in this last 6 months, by the number of pundits of amiable and liberated incarnation who've said to me, their eyes blazing with hope, that the Cold War is over. And now here I am, I'm really sort of about to become completely redundant because here I am rabbiting on perpetually about fuddy-duddy weapon systems and, you know, budgets and things like that. And it's all over. It's, you know, there's a whole new world adorning, and henceforth such questions as East-West rivalry, US versus Russia, are going to become very old-fashioned, and that we'll be considering much more the emerging, you know, the changes visited on the world by the complete common market of 1992 that Alexander was referring to, or Japan, or North-South, or other things. I would say, in my opinion at least, and this should come as a word of good cheer to at least any of you from Massachusetts, one of the more prominent military-industrial states of the Union, that I think such expectations are premature. It is true that Gorbachev has grasped, you know, an essential truth, which is that, you know, the Cold War is assisted by has been certainly propelled along by the Soviets' willingness over the years to really follow the American the American game plan. You can, in terms of military expenditures, the Americans talked about the Soviet threat to Western Europe and how the Soviets might invade Western Europe, which is the hardy, you know, which is the dawn of it all, really. The Soviets obligingly talked about, you know, NATO's potential capability to invade Eastern Europe and armed accordingly. The most ridiculous example I always thought was Star Wars. I remember that on the day after Reagan gave his inaugural speech on Star Wars, I was having lunch with a Pravda correspondent, and I suggested to him, he said, oh, what do you think, you know, asked me what I thought about it all. I said, well, the Soviets could deal with it, then Chairman Andropov could deal with it very quickly by getting up and making an announcement to the effect that the Soviet people sent their sincere condolences to the American people, who are once again about to be pillaged in order to finance a ridiculous boondoggle. And they extended their sincere sympathies for this. But if anyone thought the Soviets were going to follow this example and try and do the same thing, they had another thing coming. Unfortunately, Andropov didn't do that, and the Russians until recently didn't do that. They said, oh, it's a very grave threat, and they could help the Americans launch a first strike, and it was destabilizing, and it was all very serious, and it was, you know. I mean, Star Wars, I hope I don't have to persuade anyone here, is a joke, technologically, in every way. I mean, it just can't work. and yet the Soviets obligingly sort of pretended that it did. And that everyone was very happy. Of course, if Andropov had followed my sensible suggestion, it would have killed Star Wars stone dead right there. It would have been a big disaster. Not least for the Route 128 round here. But no, they played the game. Now, Gorbachev recently, I mean, that's been very encouraging, an encouraging thing has happened, has started to make remarks like that, saying, well, you know, it's all pointless, and why should we bother to oppose it since it won't work anyway, and, you know, who needs more nuclear weapons anyway, and very subversive remarks like that. But I'm afraid it won't be enough. Already within the bowels of the intelligence community, they have lengthy studies showing that actually Soviet Star Wars research is increasing. Since Mr. Bush has asked for direct briefings by the CIA every morning, presumably he'll be getting an earful of this. we can see that, in fact, the Soviet threat will continue to live for the purposes for which it's intended. I mean, if you look back at it, they've never needed a Soviet reality, a military reality, to invoke the threat. For example, in 1946, the Soviet Union had no navy whatsoever. I mean, they had had a large navy at the time of the German invasion. It had all been sunk, or most of it had been sunk in the first few hours of the German, or certainly in the first few months of the German attack. They had some coastal patrol boats in the Northern Fleet. In fact, they had there was so little of the Soviet fleet left that they'd used 400,000 sailors as infantry troops in the campaigns in southern Russia. This didn't prevent Admiral Nimitz, Chief of Naval Operations, stating in early 1946 that the Soviets now had the capability to blockade not just Britain, but the whole of Western Europe at that moment in time. I mean, there's complete disconnect with reality. In 1955, at a time when the Soviet armed forces, Soviet army, was still relying a huge proportion of its transport on horses and mules, the American chief of staff of the Air Force, General Twining, led a high-ranking delegation to the Soviet Union, where actually Marshal Zhukov, the then Minister of Defense, I suppose, getting tired of hearing night after night about the Soviet threat, he said rather mildly, he said, "I think you have the estimate of our forces a little too high," which of course was written off straightforward as cunning Bolshevik disinformation. We know how to deal with that. And they returned home and said, in their view, the Soviets were rapidly approaching a point when they could successfully challenge our technological supremacy. And this, of course, was treated very seriously, taken into due consideration, and led to, well, augmented by Sputnik, which indeed was a considerable technological achievement, but I fear a rather isolated one, and led to the build-up, first of all, of the huge bomber fleet, and then to the missile fleet, the American missile fleet. So this goes on down the way. I mean, many of you may be familiar with the various great gaps, the historic gaps that have marked wonderful, great milestones in the onward progression of the American military build-up. And there was the bomber gap, which was followed by the missile gap. If you remember, that was the time when the Soviets were meant to have 200 missiles and turned out to have 4 ICBMs. Then there was the civil defense gap, which was always my favorite, which was that at the touch of a button, the peal of a bell, the entire Soviet population could scurry underground and exist for weeks, if not months, while the nuclear holocaust raged overhead and then emerged to take over the admittedly rather dingy ashes of a radioactive world. This was, treated incredibly seriously, was taken into account in the war planning, because at one time there was a fantastic, ferocious row broke out between the Central Intelligence Agency and the Defense Intelligence Agency as to the precise, how many really secure, what was the space for the Soviet leadership, the reserve for the Soviet leadership in the civil defense command, in the command bunkers around Moscow? And therefore, could it be 200,000 people of the sort of top party apparat who could, absolutely exist in complete safety during nuclear war, was only 100,000 people? The argument came down to whether, if you said that someone could exist for several weeks in 1 square meter of space, then you got the 100,000. If you chopped it back to 0.5 square meter, you got 200,000. The argument, at one point, to resolve the argument, they went down to a popular nightclub in downtown Washington called the Blue Angel and took photographs, this is absolutely true, took photographs of the dance floor, which were then blown up and used in super secure, highly classified briefings. They'd see, well, that chap, you see, he's quite close to the girl, but not that close, and he could probably still stand there for actually exist in that way for, well, several weeks. The square meter types won, the sort of namby-pamby, dovish, comsimp CIA who held out for the square meter carried the day yet again. And I think we all know about the moles. So information. In fact, it's worth observing that the military, I mean, within, in terms of viewing communism, the military, of course, have always been big fans of communism. They really like the way that, in their view, you know, the military seem to be absolutely top dogs in the Soviet Union and can just, you know, have total command, first priority on all resources. That seems to be a very sensible way to run an economy. They like all these stories they hear about how, you know, that you can, that all the defense plants in the Soviet Union, for instance, get their power, their energy at a whacking discount. Sounds very sensible indeed. And in fact, there was an interesting demonstration of this in the early 1970s. The CIA, as you may remember, the Soviet defense budget, as retailed by the CIA, suddenly doubled, which was used to create, that was the budget gap, I forgot to mention that one. The reason, of course, that the Soviet defense budget doubled in dollar terms was that the CIA suddenly concluded that Soviet defense plants were half as efficient as they'd previously thought. It had been the previous sort of orthodoxy that Soviet defense plants were actually run much more efficiently than non-defense plants. And, you know, people got to work on time and worked very well and sort of had good time and motion studies and everything. Then suddenly in 1974, they concluded that actually, no, it was just as sort of sloppy and inefficient as the rest of the economy. And therefore, to produce, you know, X number of tanks and Y numbers of planes and so forth, they'd need twice as many resources to do it. So therefore, it cost twice as much. This turned out to be a marvelous public relations tool, of course, and leaving out the bit about, you know, inefficiency, that the Soviets suddenly doubled their defense budget. So we had to do the same, which, by the way, is what we've done. The DIA, I mentioned this because the defense intelligence agents, the military types, were horrified at this. They said, what do you mean the Soviets are very inefficient, their military plants? They're not. And again, a big bureaucratic sort of intelligence war broke out with the DIA producing lots of charts and super secret communications intercepts to show that in the Soviet defense sector everything went, you know, worked absolutely swimmingly, and they were really the equal of the United States in matters military technological. A particularly nutty intelligence general Keegan, who was a big advocate of the civil defense gap, he, part of his briefing, which I think he gave about 400 times to various prominenti members of the American nomenclatura around the country, said that the Soviets were graduating 700 engineers a year. And so therefore, you know, it was really almost all up, all hope was lost, because we were only graduating, I've gotten far fewer. 700,000 engineers a year. Well, it turned out actually he was including plumbers in that. That's the tried and true techniques of threat inflation, which I think still hold true today. So how big is the point, I think, facing the central question facing the military-industrial complex here is how bad is the threat of glasnost and perestroika? I must say my faith in, you know, my pessimistic certainties wavered a bit a while back when they invited a congressional delegation to tour the Krasnoyarsk radar. As you remember, the Krasnoyarsk radar, which is a very large, huge phased array radar in Siberia, has done yeoman service over the past few years as an example. It's been held up as an example of Soviet perfidy in breaking the ABM treaty, because according to the ABM treaty, it shouldn't be in the interior of Russia, it has to be on the borders. And also in evidence that the Soviets are pressing ahead with an ABM nuclear warfighting capability. And then was Krasnoyarsk, and we heard, you know, there would be leaks in the New York Times that according to intelligence experts who have studied satellite photographs, yes, it looks very bad and so on. Suddenly, the treacherous Soviets invited a congressional delegation to come and have a look around. And it wasn't just sort of dovish comsimps like Tom Downey of Long Island who were invited on the trip. There was a chap called Tony Batista. Now, you may not know, but Tony Batista is one of the most important people in this country. He is Research and Development Staff Director of the House Armed Services Committee and has been absolutely crucial in pursuing a sort of watchdog role in making sure American nuclear forces are up to snuff and well-funded. It was he, for example, who kept the B-1 bomber alive when Jimmy Carter thought he'd cancelled it, showing who's really in charge here. Carter thought he'd cancelled the B-1 bomber. Batista simply renamed it the Advanced Manned Strategic Bomber Brackets Research and continued to put the money through the budget. Made no difference whatsoever. They had to close down the production line for a few years, but kept it going. Anyway, so the Russians invited Batista along. He walked around the radar, came out, and he says, well, it's technologically pretty uninteresting, and it's certainly no use for fighting a nuclear war, and I don't think it's any threat to anyone. At that moment, I thought, well, maybe it is all over. I mean, if this is what's happening. But immediately the Pentagon issued statements saying that Mr. Batista was mistaken, he wasn't shown all the radar, it was, you know, they didn't show him that room, you know, that third door on the left, which is where it's all going. And they just dismissed him. I mean, you know, once he started saying this guy who is, you know, does know what he's talking about, you know, they just dismissed what he said because it was the wrong thing. Frank Gaffney, who was Richard Perle's successor at the Pentagon, set up the next day and said that Mr. Batista was certainly mistaken for reasons we don't quite understand. So, it just shows what happens if you jump off the party line. Now, the threat of perestroika, of course, I mean, maybe the old anti-communist bear, I mean, the old communist bear, rather, won't be able to do its duty anymore. That's being dealt with easily enough. Frank Carlucci, for example, said late last year that, in fact, a perestroika Soviet Union might pose an even greater threat. Because, whereas we know the, you know, communism had not necessarily produced the most efficient form of economic management, thus military research and development, military production in the past, if he really gets things going and turns that place around, we could be looking into a significantly greater threat in the out years, which is Pentagonese for later. Admiral Trost, I noticed, the Chief of Naval Operations, who was unveiling Navy 21, which is their big plan for the 21st century, which I know seem to include catamarans, as they know, which look like fun, and robot ships that won't need human intervention at all, which should come as good cheer to anyone travelling on Iranian Airlines, I must say, but so much what the humans in the US Navy have managed to do. Anyway, he said, yes, the New York Times correspondent, Mr. Halloran, said, well, you know, perestroika, threat, receding, perhaps. I didn't push that one very hard, but Trost said, well, indeed, that the, you know, the same thing, that as the, you know, perestroika, we think that, you know, a Soviet Union, which, you know, they really can, you know, really get going and start, you know, being more efficient and turning out, you know, really making big strides in the area of high technology will pose a greater threat. So I don't think we need worry too much that real changes in the Soviet Union are actually going to have much effect on the eternal verities here. They didn't, after all, back in the days of détente. Remember détente? They didn't really have a big effect. It's true the American defense budget went through a slight dip at that point, but was more to do with the end of the Vietnam War and, you know, anti-militarist sentiment in this country engendered thereby. I mean, it only went on for a year or so. That went straight back up. Jimmy Carter, I mean, we know what the people want. Jimmy Carter campaigned for and won the presidency in 1976 on a promise to cut the defense budget. He said the defense budget could be cut by at least $7 billion. That was back in 76 when the defense budget was rather sort of puny, less than $100 million. $7 billion doesn't buy you much these days, but it sounded like a lot of money then, and people endorsed it. Of course, what happened within a few weeks of his election was they unveiled the report of Team B, which said that the Soviet Union was about to achieve the capability to launch a disabling first strike on the United States. And then the rest was history. That led to MX, Carter's complete capitulation to the military-industrial complex. Remember, it was Jimmy Carter, indeed, went further than Ronald Reagan was ever prepared to do. He was going to concrete over the whole of the state of Nevada for the MX racetrack. Shows what happens when you listen to defense experts from, among other places, MIT and Harvard, which were very keen on that, some of them anyway. So the, and we can also, as Alexander mentioned, we can rest assured that the press, although there have been a number of, defense reporting has made good strides in the last 5 years, thanks to a very brilliant job of manipulation by Pentagon dissidents, the so-called military reform movement, people will fall into line. I mean, I can guarantee you that if it becomes absolutely necessary to prove Soviet SDI research is going well, that Malcolm Brown in the New York Times or someone in the LA Times, I mean, the pieces will flow. I mean, it's very easy to do it. All you have to do is show people some classified, photographs and give them a briefing. It'll happen. I know several of the reporters who are now, doing good stuff on the Pentagon, who are being hauled in. And told them in their ways. The chief of staff of the Air Force personally went to see the editorial board of the Chicago Tribune the other day to complain about their defense correspondent David Evans, who's particularly irritant to them because he's actually an ex-colonel of Marines and knows whereof he speaks. But you're allowed to go so far. When it becomes important, these plucky journalists will be reined in. I hope my friend Fred Kaplan of the Boston Globe is one of the last to go, but we'll see. Comparing Carter's election campaign in 1976, which, as we see, turned out to be utterly futile on the subject of the defense budget, since, it rocketed up almost immediately, despite his pledge to cut it and the endorsement of the electorate for same. This time, what have we had? We've had two candidates both pledging to maintain and increase where necessary the defense budget. Dukakis's first statement, I remember several months ago, which is after which I basically stopped reading any pronouncements he might make about defense, was he thought a $300 billion defense budget was about right. It sort of felt right to him. seemed like a nice round number. Bush, of course, we know about. So there's absolutely no threat of it being cut. We do, however, have an amusing situation in that all the years, the military, make plans ahead. They don't just plan from year to year. They have to plan, what's going to be happening next year. In fact, the year after. In fact, they make 5-year plans. At the moment, they're facing a bit of a ticklish situation because all the plans they've been making call for, in 5 years' time, a $400 billion defense budget. I mean, if you add them all up, what the Navy wants, what the Navy intends to build, what the Air Force intends to build, the Army, the intelligence agency, and so forth, it adds up to over $400 billion, which actually they probably can't get. I mean, you can keep the defense budget at around $300 billion, but you're not going to go that much further. However, so they'll have to cut somewhere. And what they'll cut is things like training for the soldiery and live ammunition for practicing, and in the end production, because what commands the process is research and development. That's what where the defense contractors make their big money these days. So we may have an interesting situation, which I look forward to greatly, which is where the armed forces of this country will have to be sacrificed to save the defense budget. Not to mention the pelf being handed out to the sort of academic hangers-on around here, including one hopes the honeybee researchers, as Alexander pointed out. So that my view is that the outlook is gloomy in terms of any change in the situation as we've had it here these last 40 years. I mean, I've been explaining that the Soviet, U.S.-Soviet relations may go up, they go down, they get better, they get worse. it really makes no difference. For reasons which have to do, I think, with the economic structure of the United States, which actually demands, has to have this infusion of defense-related cash, it is inconceivable that the budget can be in any way significantly cut, and the budget is the key. I mean, forget what you hear. You have to look at what they're spending. But the budget can be significantly cut, and therefore, to support that, the rhetoric has to be kept in tune. I mean, you can have friendly relations for a while, and Mr. Carlucci, you can go to Moscow and watch a huge firepower demonstration, things like that. But in the end, they have to adjust rhetoric to suit. So therefore, I foresee an ongoing Cold War unless and until we have a fundamental restructuring of the way things are organized around here. Thank you very much.
Okay, now we'll turn for the assessment of how the Soviet Union is actually reported, how most people perceive the place, to Patrick, who's well qualified since he spent, as I said before, a couple of years watching this process unfold in the Soviet Union.
Thanks. I'll speak for a shorter period than previous speakers, but exiguous amount of time left. And perhaps best if I started by describing the conditions, circumstances over the last 3 to 4 years in which news is produced about the Soviet Union. And was it produced by an extraordinarily small number of people in rather peculiar circumstances? There are about 400 foreign correspondents in Moscow. Not just Western correspondents, this includes everybody from Bulgarian news agency to Iraqi national agency, and many of whom have dubious connections with journalistic profession. And of these 400, you live generally in about 20 foreigner-only blocks scattered around central Moscow. You live in the center of the city. If you leave the city, you have to give the authorities 2 working days' notice before you move out. Then they have to object. They don't want you to go there. The circumstances are of some significance because they tend to induce a gentle or persistent paranoia in those who are doing the reporting of the news in Moscow, which one should always bear in mind in reading anything from there. In many cases, certainly these days, it doesn't have an enormous impact. It used to have a pervasive impact when I first went there in 1984. And certainly, although I share Andrew's misgivings about the future of the, so to speak, the second round of détente, which I think is quite fragile, it certainly is true that the way the news is reported from Moscow, the way the news can be reported, is one of the things that's changed most of all. Above all, perhaps, in quantity, that there used to be really quite limited amount. Now there's this sort of media carpet bombing, which tends to occur around summits. I would have thought of unreadable length for most people looking at their newspaper. In 1984, when I first went there, was the final dog days of the old regime, which was at that point physically dying. There wasn't so much an atmosphere of terror ever, but there was somewhat an atmosphere of sort of aging sergeants still minding the system, felt that people should go through the drill, didn't much care if they believed in it or not, and if you didn't harry them too much, they didn't harry you. But certainly their attitude to the press was basically that it was a security problem rather than an information problem. I could sort of see their point. I mean, the situation was very simple, that if you ran into a Soviet official, your first question was, where was the leader? And he said the leader's on holiday. And you say the leader has not been seen for 6 weeks. And he would then say, well, he's still on holiday. The mistake that I think I made, most people made, was imagine that most people one talked to actually knew what was happening, which they didn't. I think it was one sort of really closely guarded secret when Andropov was dying. I think probably half the Politburo was asking the same question that I was. It was politically very important. Very few people actually knew what was happening. And obviously in these circumstances, information hard to come by. I remember in the end of 1984, when Marshal Ustinov, the defense minister, died, the first we knew about it was that the World Chess Championship was going on in central Moscow at that moment. There's a hall in central Moscow called the Union Hall. And two correspondents, I think from Associated Press, turned up to cover the chess match, which had been going on endlessly. Everybody was very bored with it. And they noticed the door was shut. So they knocked. Nothing happened for a bit. Knocked again. Eventually, a cleaning woman opened the door. And they said, well, when's the chess match starting? And she said, well, it isn't, because it's been transferred somewhere else. And they said, well, why isn't it happening today? And she said, well, it's for the lying in state. And they said, well, the lying in state of who? And she said, well, of Marshal Ustinov, who's dead. And they said, the defense minister, you're telling us that the defense minister has just died and his body's going to be placed in this hall today for the lying in state. And she said, that's right, and closed the door. So they went back to the office, thought about this fairly carefully, switched on the radio, noticed the music seemed to be on the solemn side. And the key to the thing we used to watch there, which at the time did not seem to be macabre, but does in retrospect, was the kind of ties that news announcers were wearing. And whenever it looked a bit greyer than usual, you began to sort of cancel your evening's activities. So anybody wearing a shirt like Alexander would be immediately welcome sight, because you knew that it was unlikely that any of the leaders had expired. But anyway, the AP correspondents went back to the office and they thought, can we put down cleaning lady told us second second or third most powerful man in the Soviet Union is dead? And they thought, no, we can't. But then they thought it over and said, who pays a cleaning woman? And they thought, well, the Soviet state. Everybody here, she ultimately works for the Soviet state. So she has an official position, so she's a Soviet official. So they wrote, Soviet official says Marshal Ustinov dead. And, well, it's a good enough source as any, but that went on really through, the key moment of change in Moscow was really 1986. That's where things really began to change. It became evident earlier that things were probably going to change. Gorbachev seemed to be sort of speaking in a more animate manner than his predecessors. But it was only 86, and probably the second half of 86, that one foreign correspondents had a much easier ride. And secondly, Soviet intellectuals and others, the message began to get home that things were really changing. But you need things to percolate through. You need people to sort of think, well, X said that, and he still seems to be holding his job. And then word percolates through the system of what you can get away with. And then towards the end of 86, there came the sort of real breakthrough. Because what pushed it through, it were two things really which speeded it up. One was Chernobyl. When the disaster occurred at Chernobyl, the initial reaction was to clamp down immediately, because the old knee-jerk reactions, which was, say, nothing has happened, then a few days later say something has happened, but not very much, it's being exaggerated by the foreign press. Demonstration that there was no radioactivity in the Ukraine consisted of putting on Ukrainian folk dancers who whirled about in the streets of Kiev to indicate that there was nothing much wrong. 10 days after the accident, the health minister of the Ukraine appeared on television in Kiev and said he thought it would be a very good idea if people stayed inside as much as they could and wash their hair at least once a day. And that was the first announcement that anything was happening. This was very chilling after watching the folk dancers doing their thing. And it also was very clear to the Politburo that this was a disaster. I mean, it was a political disaster at home, because nobody's going to trust a word you say after that. And it was a political disaster abroad. It was after they'd had their unilateral test ban in order to encourage credibility of Soviet offers and so forth. And you can't have any credibility if you then try and hush up a major nuclear accident. And it was one of, I think, a critical moment that it was demonstrated that it just wouldn't work. That if you allowed, in other words, if you allow a vacuum of information to exist on any matter of major domestic or international interest, you can do that, and basically say, to hell with them. But you pay an enormous political price, because you then becomes almost impossible to explain your position to anybody. So this was a sort of critical moment for the development of Glasnost and the position of foreign correspondents. There was a sort of hiccup over the Danilov affair, which was the end of 86, but already that was changing. I mentioned earlier that the peculiar living circumstances of foreign correspondents, and actually of all foreigners, expatriates in Moscow, does have an effect on this rather sort of bizarre community, which in some ways is like a sort of small but exaggerated idea of what people imagine the Soviet society to be like as a whole. I remember the day I arrived in Moscow, the same day Mrs. Gandhi had been assassinated, and I thought it indicative of a certain insensitivity which grows up in small besieged communities, that I went to a fancy dress party, of all things, it was Halloween during the evening, and one correspondent, a girl, had dressed up as Mrs. Gandhi with her clothes covered in ketchup, which she thought was quite a funny joke for the evening. And I sort of said, well, doesn't display a certain insensitivity to recent events. And she said, seemed jolly enough to her, but it did occur to me at the time, this was perhaps indicative of a problem which grows in all communities, that small communities that feel they're besieged, that they become almost wholly desensitized to how people perceive them on the outside. Much of this was clearly not just propaganda on the part of correspondents there or there. It was an amazingly stupid thing for the Soviets to have done. They had created a sort of system of dealing with the foreign press which was almost guaranteed to produce limited information, generally hostile attitude. There were other reasons this occurred, longer-term reasons, but the general atmosphere was one of medium to extensive paranoia. And of course, things like the sort of Danilov case inevitably exacerbated this. There's nothing like journalists feeling they might be arrested to rush off and write some disobliging piece about the local authorities. Since 86, in some ways, coverage has got better. It's certainly got much more extensive. But I don't think it's got... the quality has improved as much as it might appear. Partly because there's still an enormous legacy of criminology which weighs down not just journalistic but academic coverage of the Soviet Union. Criminology, I suppose, has got many aspects. Some of them very much discredited since 1984-85, because everything has developed very differently from what criminologists predicted, but still has enormous impact. For instance, one major attitude is Soviet Union, completely totalitarian state, wholly controlled from the top, in which the only sort of active element is some mechanism in the Politburo. This was never so. What I thought one of the most interesting figures I saw about the Soviet Union was that there are 17 million unlicensed firearms in the Soviet Union. the police, the commander of the police in Moscow, said, when questioned about how he could increase security, said, well, our major problem is that there are 17 million unlicensed firearms here. And there have been for a long time. So it is worth sort of bearing in mind when looking at this country, a country which is meant to be wholly controlled from the top, in which the action of every citizen is scrutinized, or at least people at the top are conscious of what's happening, is that there is this enormous, they don't actually know what happened to 17 million guns. And it is that sort of atmosphere of the Soviet Union, this one moment, apparently long arm of the state in action, and another moment, absolutely sort of anarchy going on.